Thanks very much. This is me. I'll be talking to you about biodiversity, disease and environmental change. And I'll just start by showing you some little kids in Arnhem Land who are out fishing, and they have a very successful fishing expedition. They bring back two or three nice, juicy, large coral trout, which get baked up, and they feed about 20 family members and friends. And this, of course, makes them very popular, because that's a pretty cool thing to do, and everybody thinks they're little heroes, until, of course, every single person who ate that fish gets sick. So all 20 people are sick. Four of them end up in hospital, one of them in intensive care. What went wrong? There was a change in the environment which caused the reef ecosystem that supported the coral trout as healthy fish. That system was disrupted, the fish became unhealthy and toxic, and they poisoned the people. And the people ended up in Gove Hospital. I'll come back to that and explain exactly what happened, but I want to just put it in context for you. There's two things that I'd like to do in this lecture. I'd like to present to you three case studies that demonstrate the relationship between biodiversity and human health. And those three studies are the fish poisoning, which I'll come straight back to, Ross River virus, which is a mosquito-borne infection, and birth defects, such as holes in hearts and cleft palates and things that arise from drinking poor quality water. The second thing is to show you how PhD students are the university's engine room. They really drive and support a lot of our research, and I can see some PhD students in the audience. Thank you for coming. So those are the two main points. If you've got those, you can tune out and I'll come back and repeat them for you at the end. So back to our fish poisoning. What's happened here? If you've got urban runoff, as happens when you build a city, that runoff goes out into the ocean, and if you happen to have a reef alongside the land, the sediment can choke the reef and the coral dies. The other thing that kills coral and destroys healthy reef ecosystems is ocean warming as part of this whole global climate change. General warming of the atmosphere warms the ocean as well, and if the sea surface temperature gets too hot, you get coral bleaching, which you've probably seen and heard of in the media. So a reef is subject to a lot of environmental disruptions, and if that healthy, biodiverse ecosystem is sufficiently disrupted, you get algal overgrowth. Okay, so one of the problems on a reef is somewhere to put your feet. Things need to get a foothold in order to grow. And if this foothold availability is crowded out by biodiversity, the evil, nasty algae can't get a foothold. When you kill the reef, they do. And on those algae, you can get small microorganisms which are toxic. And this particular one is very toxic. It has a nerve toxin. And when the fish eat the algae, these are herbivorous fish, and they eat the algae, they accumulate the toxin in their bodies, and then when the people eat the fish, they get poisoned. And symptoms of that poisoning include a whole range of unpleasant effects, including respiratory arrest. It can kill you. But most interestingly, I guess, is the temperature reversal, where the nerves that detect heat detect cold instead, and vice versa. So everything that's hot feels cold, and everything that's cold feels hot, which is a pretty dangerous situation, you can imagine, if you're dealing with campfires and things. This problem occurs in tropical areas where people depend on reef fish. So right across the, using Queensland school mackerel as example, right across the northern part of Australia, and people regularly get reported with this fish poisoning from those areas. The Pacific obviously has a lot of coral as well, and if you look at the disease pattern in the Pacific, you see something very interesting. In some countries, you get a lot of cases. So 5 cases per 1,000 population. That's quite a few cases in islands like Tuvalu, which is here. And Fiji has very few cases, which is here. And you may be able to see there's a sea surface temperature pattern here. The dark area is pretty stable and coolish, and the lighter area here is very much subject to El Nino temperature fluctuations. So the degree to which this ocean warms up will determine how much coral is bleached, which relates to how many people might get poisoned from ciguatera. So we got a PhD student, Simon Hales, to have a look at the relationship between sea surface temperature and anomaly in sea surface temperature and the number of cases. So this is the number of cases of ciguatera poisoning per year along this axis. This is the anomaly, in other words, how unusually warm the ocean was. And these points represent individual years. So you can see in years when the ocean is unusually hot, you get an unusually large number of cases of ciguatera poisoning. And that pattern is consistent in lots and lots of these islands in the area that's subject to high ocean temperatures. In the areas that have a more stable ocean temperature, you get no such relationship at all. So the statistics definitely bear out the fact that in the variable area, there's a strong relationship between ocean temperature and number of cases of fish poisoning. I'm not enough of a philosopher to know whether this is inductive reasoning or deductive reasoning or none of the above, but my brain tells me that the sea surface temperature is a form of ecosystem disruption. It's disrupting the reef ecosystem. And if that ecosystem disruption has adverse health outcomes, if people are getting sick as a result of that, then I'm happy to conclude that conserving a healthy reef ecosystem is protective of human health. Okay, so that will be a recurring theme. I hope this case, at least by Simon Hales, shows that that's the case. So let's move on to another one, Ross River virus, which is a mosquito-borne disease. We get about 5,000 cases every year in Australia, and it's considered to be an emerging infectious disease because the more we disrupt the environment, the more cases we seem to get. 100 years ago, there was no epidemics of Ross River virus at all, and now there's 5,000, and it's occurring in places where it didn't occur before. So it's, from that point of view, it's an emerging public health problem. What it gives you is a characteristic rash on a random body part, constitutional symptoms like fever and rheumatic symptoms like sore joints and sore muscles, and some unlucky people can develop a post-viral type syndrome where they can have these symptoms recurring for up to a couple of years, which is obviously quite debilitating. It never kills anyone, but these things can last generally for a few weeks and sometimes for a couple of years. So what's happening with Ross River virus is, back in the days greater than 50,000 or so years ago, before there were people in Australia, this thing evolved quite happily as an animal virus. So the Ross River virus lives in kangaroos, and mosquitoes transmit it from kangaroo to kangaroo, and the kangaroos get immunity to it, and then the joeys that grow up the following generation are the next victims for that virus to be transmitted. And along come people, and what can happen is that the mosquitoes, some of which are less discriminating than others, some will bite only some groups of animals, but the less discriminating mosquitoes that will also bite people can transmit the disease to people, and then you get the symptoms that I've just showed you, and you can get an epidemic with human-to-human transmission as well. So, how does this relate to environmental change? If we look at what's happened where agricultural development has cut down native vegetation. So these are deep-rooted tree-type vegetation with a lot of water being sucked up out of the water table by the trees. Okay, so evapotranspiration is the trees sucking up the water and then evaporating it out into the atmosphere through the stomates, which is how they create their own moist, cool microclimate. For those of you who have walked into a rainforest, that's why it feels cool. If you cut down these trees, you lose that sucking up water effect, and the water table rises. And if the water table rises through an area of historically deposited salt, which is a lot of Australia because it's a very old continent, then that salt is brought to the surface, kills the remaining vegetation, because these guys get salt on their toes and they don't like that. And you can create a salty, dead tree desert environment, if you like. This here is a mosquito trap, looking at what sort of mosquitoes live in that desert, that salty desert that's been created by human modification of the environment. This occurs in pretty well every state, South Australia, huge and very damaging problem in agricultural areas of Western Australia, New South Wales and Victoria as well. And clearly, this is a huge productivity issue for farmers because they lose arable land. And this is another theme that I'd like you to start thinking about, which is the relationship between the productivity losses, the environmental benefits of biodiversity, and human health. There is a relationship there. So we know that there is this economic productivity loss that's been well assessed and documented, and we went to see whether there was a health effect as well. And Andrew Jardine, another PhD student, he tried to get a handle on how mosquito populations would be affected by this type of scenario where the trees are dying and there's salty water lying on the surface. This scheme explains to us what's happening. So this bit I've been through with you: land clearing, water table rising, salinization of freshwater ecosystem, decreasing biodiversity, because a lot of animals get knocked out that can't cope with the salt. And when those animals, when that biodiversity is reduced, two specific types, functional groups of animals that you lose are competitors. So mosquito larvae have fewer other types of aquatic organisms competing with them for the same food resources in the same puddle, and that means that the mosquitoes do better. And they have fewer predators. So the mosquito larvae lose predators, which means that more mosquitoes survive and are produced. So there's an increased probability of a single mosquito species becoming a dominant animal in that ecosystem. And if that mosquito happens to be a vector of human disease, as is the case here, Aedes camptorhincus, which is a salt-tolerant vector of Ross River virus, you get an increased risk of vector-borne disease and increased human disease burden, which obviously costs health dollars. To quantify this bit of the equation here, of course, we needed another PhD student, and that was Scott Carver, who's seen here holding the moon. What he did was drive around Western Australia and sample saltwater bodies and looked at the number of competitors and the number of predators and the number of mosquitoes in those saltwater bodies. And being a person who loves being in the field and loves driving around in four-wheel drives and getting dirty, that was just the best PhD project, you know, he could possibly have conceived. So he had a fantastic time, and this is what he found. This is the number of predators in the puddle here, and this is the salinity of the puddle here, and each point is a puddle. And you can clearly see that the saltier it gets, the fewer the predators are in that puddle. So that's confirming the relationship between biodiversity loss and the ability of the vector mosquito to become a dominant species in that ecosystem. So going back to our little flowchart about, you know, what's happened here, the environmental change in this case is soil salinization. The biodiversity loss is the predators and the competitors. You've disrupted the freshwater ecosystem, and the result is human disease, epidemics of human disease in that system. All right, so that's case number two. An extension of that is a different environmental change in operating in the same system. So instead of salinization, we could say urbanization, because building this clearly decreases biodiversity. There's not as many predators and competitors available to knock mosquitoes out of an ecosystem in this sort of environment as there would be in a natural environment. And whether that biodiversity loss also leads to human disease, we don't know, but we'd like to find out. So we got another PhD student, Emily Johnson. That's research in action in Adelaide, addressing the same research question, but in a different way, with a different environmental disruption. Again, if I can generalize from that, at least for the case where we had the salinity, we know that conservation of natural vegetation decreases risk of Ross River virus, because it sucks up that salt and the predators and competitors can come back and suppress the disease vectors. So a second case, I think, where we've demonstrated that link between biodiversity and human health, or at least a healthy ecosystem and human health. Okay, so where are we? Those were the two aims. We've looked at ciguatera fish poisoning, we've looked at Ross River virus. I'd like to now move to a slightly less direct example, which involves birth defects. So, a little bit of water 101. In a clean, uninhabited catchment with natural vegetation, that natural vegetation acts as a natural filter for bacteria and other pathogens, microbes that can make you sick, being washed into the waterway. So if you have 0.6 hectares per person, that gives you safe water for people to drink. Now, cities obviously overtax the ability of the environment to supply clean water, and we have bacteria and other pathogens flowing into the water, which then need to be chlorinated. That's why we chlorinate our water, so that we don't get sick from drinking the water. And when we add disinfection products like chlorine to the water to kill the microbes, there's natural organic matter in the water, because that runs in from the catchment as well. That natural organic matter reacts with the chlorine and forms chlorination byproducts, one group of which is the trihalomethanes, THMs. And these guys are unfortunately toxic. Okay, so they've been associated with bladder cancer, birth defects, endocrine disruption, asthma, a number of other diseases that we won't go into. But the birth defects, the ones that we're focusing on today, is what I'll show you a study of. It so happened that in Western Australia, there's a natural experiment to test this relationship between water quality and human health, catchment management and human health, if you like. So what you've got in Perth is a low trihalomethane area because people up here use groundwater. So this is Perth here. This is north of Perth, where we're sort of moving into the desert. It's very dry and people depend on groundwater. At the other end, we're moving down towards Margaret River. Not quite, it's down through the floor somewhere. But there's a lot more rainfall, and these people depend on surface water. So natural organic matter in water from surface runoff plus chlorine equals trihalomethanes. High exposure area, low exposure area because they're using bore water with no organic matter in it, and somewhere in between. So Kim Chisholm, who is the PhD student who did this particular work, went and measured the trihalomethane levels and found that, as one might expect, the average trihalomethane level increased from north to south. And also the maximum values increased from north to south. The peaks of trihalomethane are perhaps the ones that are most damaging if they're consumed at a time in the first trimester when the fetus is most vulnerable to environmental toxins in terms of causing birth defects. So these peaks are quite important, and these sort of peaks are getting very, very uncomfortably high. Next thing then is to look at the number of birth defects in that same natural experiment. And in the low exposure area, there are fewer birth defects over a 5-year period here, 2000 to 2004, increasing number of birth defects. And the epidemiology students in the audience will immediately say, yeah, but you know, what if there are more people living in that area? Exactly. So you need to use your denominator, a favorite tool of all epidemiologists, and you look at the rate instead, or the percentage, and surprise, surprise, you still get a consistent pattern, increasing percentage of birth defects as you move along that gradient from low to high toxin levels. Number of other things you could add in here. So, but what about maternal age and smoking and socioeconomic status, a number of previous kids, and a whole lot of other things that might lead to birth defects? There might be more women smoking in a particular suburb or whatever. So you adjust for those and you create what's called an adjusted odds ratio. It takes all of those things into account, and you take the lowest exposure as one, and you look how many more times likely you are to have a birth defect if you live in the high exposure area, and that comes out at 22%. All right, so the women in that southern area drinking the surface water are 22 times more likely to have birth defects with all of those other factors adjusted for. Now, that's not a huge difference, but it's a very significant public health problem because there's a huge number of people exposed. Right? There are a lot of pregnant women in the community. So small increase compared to, say, smoking, which bumps up your cancer risk by, you know, several tensfolds, but with a large population exposed, that's still a very significant public health problem. This made the headlines in the paper in Western Australia in 2008, and that's when I left the state. Okay, so what do we do about this? You could provide pregnant women with bottled water. That would solve the problem, wouldn't it? Does that sound like good public health practice? Not very equitable, is it? Not everybody can afford to drink bottled water. You could upgrade all of the treatment plants in Australia to remove the trihalomethanes. Problem with that is we got really crap water in Australia. Okay, so the standards for trihalomethanes that we set in Australia are much higher than any other Western country. And that's because we have so little water, we have to put up with poor quality water. So yes, we could do it, but it would cost billions and billions of dollars, and roads and hospitals and schools would not happen because we're talking about a limited resource. So I'd like to, suggest that catchment management might help, because if you conserve the catchment ecosystem, you'll get that natural filtration effect to produce cleaner water and provide an ecosystem service which is providing clean, safe drinking water to the population. Riparian vegetation, meaning vegetation along rivers or freshwater bodies that have this function of filtering water before it runs in, kills bacteria. Right? It does that by delaying the runoff, so the bacteria stay out of the water for longer, and that cuts into the bacteria's half-life. Right? So the longer it takes for them to get in the water, the more bacteria die before they do, and the cleaner is the water. So the longer you can retain those bacteria or remove them completely, because soil organisms eat them up, the cleaner the water and the lower the chlorine demand. So these figures here just show that filtration system can be just as effective as primary and secondary sewage treatment. So there are fewer microbes, bacteria going into the water, you need less chlorination, and if you're putting less chlorine in, you're producing less trihalomethanes. If you're producing less trihalomethanes, there'll be fewer birth defects. So as I said, it's a series of fairly indirect links, but every single one of them is quantifiable. So what's happened? Environmental change, at this time in the form of catchment management. If you don't have the biodiversity in the catchment, you get bacteria in the water that need treating, and the chemicals that result from that treatment cause human disease. So I think this is another example. What I've shown you is three examples of Australian studies that demonstrate this link. What I haven't shown you is a hell of a lot of international evidence, for example, from Lyme disease, that supports the same story. And you therefore have to ask whether the conclusion is generalizable, and obviously, based on those studies and the international evidence, I feel very much that it is. Disease burden can be reduced by conservation measures, at least in some situations. So if we just have a quick look here, this is the federal budget is just under $250 billion, and about 16 to 18% of that, about $40 billion per annum, is spent on health. There's also a hell of a lot of money spent on biodiversity, conservation, on land restoration, remediation, mine site rehabilitation. There's a lot of stuff that goes into ecosystem restoration and biodiversity conservation. And the problem as I see it is that those environmental initiatives do not talk to the health initiatives. So if we want to conserve biodiversity because it supports human health, as we've just seen in those three cases, that's a really good political ally. That's a powerful advocacy tool. Now, of course, there are a lot of people that will say it's a very utilitarian approach. There are ethical and philosophical reasons for conserving biodiversity, and all of that is true. I'm not saying that we should only conserve biodiversity because it supports human health. What I'm saying is that it's a very powerful ally to the conservation movement, and the two should work in unison, but at the moment don't speak to each other. So if we could get some sort of optimization of investment and intervention that benefits both health and environment concurrently, then that would be a very cost-effective thing to do. We would need to understand better the relationship between biodiversity and health to make that argument stronger, which obviously calls for more research. You can't conclude a talk on research without asking for more research money. So we need more research investment in establishing how this relationship works so that we can optimize the interventions that we devise. At the moment, they're happening in a disjointed fashion between environment and health. So in order to solve these types of big multidisciplinary problems that involve environment, health, economy, we really need large multidisciplinary collaborations. And those will be underpinned by PhD student ideas and PhD student labor, as I've tried to show you in this presentation. So in concluding, I'd like to thank the students whose work went into this and open the floor for any questions. Thank you very much.